Hey, good morning, First Christian. Yeah. Hey, it's good to see you. I'm glad you're here. I know that today we have a small crowd, and I appreciate everybody being here. I know people are traveling. It's Christmas time. They heard it was my birthday and all sorts of stuff. So, I'm just glad that you're here. I'm glad that we can worship together. I'm glad that we can celebrate together. And hoping people are going to be able to log in at home and be able to see what's happening here. Because no matter what it's doing outside, no matter how warm it is, no matter how much rain we're getting, we get to come in here and we get to worship and we get to praise and we get to glorify our God. And it's a really, really, really good thing. So I hope that you're ready to do that. I hope you're ready to pray. I hope you're ready to sing. I hope you're ready to take communion, listen to a message. I hope you're ready because it's going to be a very good morning this morning. Hope when you walked in this morning, you received one of these things. It's called our bulletin. If you want to turn on the back, take a look at some stuff. One of the things is today is our birthday celebration for Jesus tonight at 5 o'clock. So Santa will be here. So if you want to come and celebrate and have Santa take pictures, whatever the case may be, it starts at 5 o'clock. That being said, that means we will not be having Sunday night service tonight at 6. It is canceled, okay? No service tonight at 6. Also, next Sunday morning, I will not be here. But John Mark Smith, he is a fantastic speaker. He will be here, and we're going to be taking a love offering for him. And you do not want to miss. I know everybody's going to be out of here today because they thought I was going to be gone. But no, that's next week. So John Mark Smith will be here. Take a love offering for him. And I will be back next Sunday night to teach the Sunday night service. All right, so I won't be here in the morning, but I will be back at night. Also, sign-up sheets in the foyer for volunteers. Take a look at what you can help with. We have a lot of the people who sign up for the same thing over and over and over again, and we're looking for new people, new fresh blood to get in there and start signing up for the nursery and communion and so forth. So that is what we are looking for. All right, that's all the announcements that I have. Would you like to stand, please, as we have our opening prayer? Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you so much for just being here. Father, I know that the weather outside is gloomy. I know that we have the rain, but Father, we know that your presence is always going to be with us. And so, Father, I'm thankful that we have a chance to come and that we have a chance to sing to you, to pray to you, fellowship with one another, and just learn from you, Father. And I'm asking, Father, that you please just continue to mold us and to make us into your family, because that is what we are. We're family. And so, Father, I ask that you please, everything that we do this morning, may it be for your glory. The songs that we sing, may we sing up to you loud and proud and just want to glorify who you are. The prayers that we pray, I hope that they're a fragrant offering. The message that we hear, the communion that we take, the offering that we give, Father, it is all for you. Nothing this morning is about us. It's all about you. And we thank you, Father, so much for all that you have done. Father, may you be glorified. May you be honored. And thank you for sending your son who came and died for us. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. Good morning. Take a moment and turn around and look at somebody close to you and tell them Merry Christmas. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being here this morning. I like it when y'all laugh. The song that we're going to start with this morning is special to me, and I'm not trying to talk about me, but it is special to me. And our children, like Collins, they missed out on so many things that we got to do as kids. All right, y'all remember when we were kids how big the back windshields were in the cars? All right. How many of you fought with your brother or sister to see who got to lay up in the back windshield on the way home? Brother Eric's one of them. I did. I fought, and I'm the oldest, so I won. But I remember coming home from my grandparents on a Christmas Eve and listening to Silent Night on the radio with me laid up in the back windshield looking for Santa Claus as the stars, as we see the stars. So this is a special song, I'm sure, to y'all, too. It epitomizes Christmas to me. So our call to worship this morning is Silent Night. We're going to sing the first, second, and fourth verses. If you would, please stand.
Echoing their joyous strain.
Good snow just last week. We had flakes this big. As old as I am, I've never seen anything that big as far as snow goes. So maybe we'll get some more before the year is over. Our praise hymn this morning is What Child Is This? It's found on page 281 in your hymnals. If you want to join looking in your hymnals, please. Just to remind myself. Our hymn of communion this morning is on page 266. It's that beautiful name that I know of, a beautiful name that angels brought down to earth. There's no other name like Jesus. If you would, please stand and join as we sing. First and third verses, please. I know.
Oh,
have a seat. I know that there are parts of the service that everybody has as their favorite. Sometimes it's the singing, sometimes it's the prayer, sometimes it's the message, sometimes it's even the offering for us. But there is nothing more important in a service than what happens right now. To remember what Jesus Christ did for us, there's nothing more important than that. So when we come together on Sundays, and we take this on a regular basis, I tell ministers when I meet them around town, they say, what do you guys do that's a little bit different than us? And I tell them, I say, we have communion on a weekly basis. And they say, how can you do that? How can you not do that? And they said, well, that'd be a lot of people making communion. And I go, it is. I said, we've got a church in Kentucky that's 23,000 people. And they have five services every Sunday morning. And all five services every single week, they take this. It's that important. And Jesus made it that important for us. Matthew chapter 26, starting in verse 26, it says, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body. So when these loaf, this cracker is passed around to you, before you take it, I want you to remember his body that was broken for us. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and offered to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. And when that cup comes around, I want you to take it and I want you to look at it. I want you to think about his blood that was shed for you. Before you take this, don't just take it. Remember what he has done for us. And make this your favorite part of the service.
Thank you. you were here for that Sunday night, wow, that was amazing, a great concert. It was so much fun. And, man, there was just a lot of people here. We had 107 that came to that cantata, and it was, people were sitting in pews that it was just great. So, it was so much fun, and thank you guys for doing it. Thank you for your dedication. Thank you for serving in that way. I see how you are. They're sitting in the back. Nice. Thanks, everybody. Friday morning I came into the office, and Samantha had been dealing with a cold all week long, and so when I got in, she didn't speak anything. Madison was in, and so we were talking, and whenever I'd ask Samantha something, she answered, because Samantha couldn't talk, you know, and so I was like, all right, and then she was like, I got to go to Walmart, I got to get the cake. I said, let me go to Walmart, I'll pick up the cake. She goes, are you sure? And I said, yes. So I went to Walmart Friday morning to pick up the cake for Happy Birthday Jesus. And I go to the bakery, they give it to me. I go back to get in the checkout lines. It was out and down several, aisles to be able to check out. And I was standing behind an elderly lady. And I looked to see if there was any of the regular checkout lanes open. There was one at the very end, and there was a line going out that. And I'm standing there holding a cake, and the lady in front of me says, and I see her look behind, and she's looking and looking, and she goes, are any of them open? I said, yes, there is, all the way down the end, and it's got a line going out that one as well. And she goes, well, that wouldn't help me very much if I went down there. And I said, no, it wouldn't. But it would help me greatly if you did. And she goes, what do you mean? I said, that would be one less person standing in front of me to get to the line. I said, if you could just pass that down, that would be great. And I must have said that loud enough that almost everybody turned around and looked at me and started laughing. Well, it went pretty quickly, and I was able to bring the cake and have that all set up for tonight. But yesterday, of course, is Saturday. Heather and I go grocery shopping in Kroger in Starkville. Wow. I'll get there. All right. So as we were walking around, we're making plans for what we're going to eat for Christmas. We got a ham. I don't like ham, but everybody else does, so we'll eat ham. And so we got a ham. And we're going around, and I said, we need to get some sort of rolls or biscuits or something. And we were right by the area, the refrigerated area, where you can buy those things. And Heather asked me, she goes, well, do you want me to make it instead of buying something? I said, no, we want it to taste good. So we're going to buy this over here. And I flinched. I was like this because I knew what was coming. She was going to hit me. Well deserved, by the way. And she didn't. I was like, oh. So I went over and grabbed some crescent rolls, put them in the cart, and started walking. This is nice. Next thing I know, wham! She smacks me in the chest so hard. And I was like, you waited for the people to leave before you did that? And she goes, no, I waited for you to relax. And I went, oh, thanks, dear. Thank you very much. All right, everybody. Christmas type-ish sermon. How about that? Turn in your Bibles to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, it's not about the birth, it's not that kind of, but it's in relation to having a Christmas sermon. So John chapter 1. I told the story about you, dear, just so you know. I told the story about Kroger where you hit me. Okay, they all know. All right. John chapter 1, starting in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the very beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. So here it is. We're talking about Jesus. And it's very clear from the very beginning. It says here, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was around from the very beginning. And then it goes on and explains, listen, because of who Jesus was, because that he is God, and he was around from the very beginning, and it says that everything that has been made through him. When God spoke and said, let there be light, through Jesus. When God made the planet, through Jesus. When God made the stars, through Jesus. Life on earth, through Jesus. Can't have life without Jesus. Couldn't. And he is the Word. Then he goes on. Starting in verse 6. There was a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light, John that is. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. And I think it's kind of neat that the man that was being used to be a witness, to talk about the things that were to come, was Jesus' cousin, John. Not the author of the book, but his cousin. And he came as a witness to talk about. They lived close by each other. They played with each other. They were around for each other. John knew that there was a particular thing that he was supposed to do. And he was supposed to be the witness to the light that was coming to share with the light of the world. And so he was there to do this. Verse 10. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own. He's saying he was there to talk to the Jews. But his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or husband's will, but born of God. Verse 14. The word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory and the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and of truth. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. That was the only way that we were going to be able to see that he was truly the light. That was the only way that we're going to be able to see that he was truly the Word of God, is if he became flesh. That's why we have Christmas. That's why what we do. I know that we can get so distracted with so many different things about the Christmas time. We can get distracted by the beautiful lights. We can get distracted by the beautiful Christmas trees and the wreaths and the presents. But we can't let that distract us from what it's really all about. The birth of Jesus. When I was in India, this was the one time of year for about a week that the Christians who lived in India were able to show that they were Christians. Only one time. The only thing that they were allowed to do to demonstrate that they were a Christian is that they would blow up a star and have it lit hanging outside their house. That was it. That was to show the world that was their Christmas tree. And it was pretty cool because around Christmas time when you're driving and there's no street lights. You're driving out in the streets at night, there's no lights at all. And you're driving and we're going through the mountains and we lived in the mountains, but we're driving through and all of a sudden you would look up and you would see a star up on a hill. Or you were driving, you would see a little star down in a village. And you know that the people all around recognized and knew where that star was. They knew what it was for. And after the Christmas time, when the star would be taken down, do you know what would happen to those people? They would get harassed. They would get chased. They would get beat. All because of a star. I think that star symbolized the star that was above and pointed the way for the wise men to find who Jesus was. That's probably the reason why they do it. They don't have Christmas trees. But it was amazing to see. And he gave light to those, and those people were his children. Look at this. Look at verse 15. John testifies concerning him. He cries out saying, "This is he whom I said, he comes after me, has surpassed me, because he was before me. From the fullness of grace we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth come through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known." Now, this was John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us the answer to take back to those who sent us. Who do you say what do you say about yourself?" And John replied with the words of Isaiah. He said, "I am the voice of the one calling in the desert. Make straight the way for the Lord." I was thinking about John, and I was thinking about us. John had a very specific job. John had a very specific idea, a very specific role in this whole thing about with Jesus. He was the one that was laying the groundwork to point people to who Jesus was. I have a feeling that there is a little bit of John in all of us. There are people that you are in contact with. There are people that you associate with. There are people that look to you for the answer, and all you're supposed to do is point them in the direction of who Jesus is. Point them, show them, help them to see who Jesus is. We all have that job. We all have that responsibility. You are John. I'm here to make straight the way and point you to who Jesus is. Do we have the answers? No. Jesus does. Do we know exactly what to say when we talk with people? No, but Jesus does. I tell people all the time, and I share with people all the time, it's about him. It's about him. It's about knowing who he is. But you have to be that kind of a person that lives the life that reflects who Jesus is so you can point them to him. Wednesday, we finally got out of our dryer. It's been over 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks since we've had a dryer. Well, it was actually the week of Thanksgiving that our dryer broke, and we were supposed to get the new one. So we've been out since then, and they finally were able to bring it to our house on Wednesday, and I went back home, and they were just about loading it off of the truck, and they were bringing it in, and as they were going up the stairs, I made sure they didn't hurt the stairs this time. Brought them up the stairs and they put them in, and one of the guys looks at me and he goes, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Absolutely." "Are you a minister?" Now, I'm wearing shorts and a t-shirt and those black fluorescent orange running shoes that I bought. I go, "Yeah, I am. How do you know?" And he goes, "Man, I just knew." He had the spirit of discernment, from if I could tell. And I'm like, wow. Just knew. But what if I wasn't acting the way that I should when I went home and he knew that I was a minister? What if I was mad because they were 15 minutes late? What if they had hit my stairs again and caused other dents and dings in them? What if I said a cuss word in front of them. What if I started yelling? What if I started doing all these things? I could not have been John. I couldn't have been. I would have ruined my testimony. I would have ruined who I was to point people to who Jesus is. And the guy asked me, he goes, where do you work? And I said, well, I'm over at First Christian Church. And he was like, where's that? And I told him where it was. And he was like, I know exactly where that is. And I'm like, man, you're invited to come at any time. And he said, that would be great. That's unlike what happened about a month ago. I was giving someone a ride from church. And I was giving them a ride home, and this person asked me, so what do you do for a living? I'm the minister at First Christian Church where you go to church. And he was like, oh, that's a full-time job? And I'm like, yes, it is. We just never know who we're going to run into and what they're going to ask. But you got to be ready like John. And point the way to the Savior. All right, let's continue on. Verse 30, this is the one I meant when I said, a man has come down after me who has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. Then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except for that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me. The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who was baptized with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God. Testify that this is the Son of God. I testify that this is the Son of God. I testify that I can point you to the Son of God. I testify that I can help you see who the Son of God is. I testify that I can point you in the right direction to know who God is. I testify that I can help you read the scriptures to know who the Son of God is. I testify that I can help you pray so that you will know who the Son of God is. I can help you do this. I will help you and point you in the right direction to know who the Son of God is. And that should be our testimony as well. Let's go on. And the next day, John was right there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. And when the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, what do you want? And they said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come, he replied. And you will see. So they went and saw where he was staying and spent that day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which translated is Peter. One of the things I like about seeing people come to know who Jesus is and being able to be a part of that transition of being able to point people to Jesus and seeing them grow spiritually is the transition that happens when they finally realize, they finally get it, they finally go, oh, that's who he is. See, those disciples of John was not upset when they went, hey, see you later, John, we're gonna go follow Jesus now. John, we appreciate everything that you've done for us, we're gonna go follow Jesus. And you know what John said? No, please don't go! No, you can't leave me. No, stay right here. Did he say that? No, he did not. He was like, good for you. Good. Go follow Jesus. Go follow after him. Go love on him. Be his disciples. And when they finally started following after Jesus, Jesus looked at him and was teaching them. And he says, listen, I'm going to change things about you. And you, I'm going to rename. And your name is Cephas. Why you want to change my name? Does it matter? Nope, I'm Cephas. I'm Peter. That's the point that we have to get to. The point of us following Jesus to the point where he says to us that he wants to change things about us. And you have to just look at him and say, okay, done. What do you want to change? I want to change your name. My name's Eric right now. What do you want it to be? I want you to be Peter. Done. Call me Peter. No, please don't call me Peter. Huh? Bartholomew. There we go. Uncle Mark. But he can change things about you, and all you have to do is say, okay, change me. Change my name. Change my habits. Change the way that I talk. Change the way that I think. Change the way that I interact. Change the way that I see situations. Change the way that I view life. Change the way all these things. And if we would just get to that point where we would submit to him in that way, so that he's that you're willing to be changed and do anything he wants, you have no idea what's going to happen. Peter, Cephas, became one of Jesus' closest friends. And Peter, Cephas, said some dumb things. And Jesus corrected him and said, all right, you done? Get back in line. All right? Doesn't mean that you're going to be perfect when he starts to change you and make you and mold you into what he wants as he changes you and shows you the way that you're supposed to live. You're going to still make mistakes. But as we see in the Gospels, what he did for Peter, what he did for Cephas to bring him back, it's okay. But we still need someone to point us in the direction of who Jesus is. And you have to get to that point where you are willing to point people to see who Jesus is, so that he can change your life. Just takes a person. Just takes a situation. It just takes commitment. It just takes following. It just takes you. If he called after you, what would you say? It's time for us to find out. Our song of invitation that we have this morning is Thou Sidst Leave the Throne. And if you need to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you need to follow after him, if you need prayer, whatever the case may be, please come down as we sing this song. And we're going to stand and we're going to sing, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne. Dustin has just come down for some prayer, and we talked about that this week, and happy to pray with Dustin. Would you please pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, I just want to ask that you please, I know life is hard. I know that we make decisions and we choose to follow you or not follow you. And Father, I know that Dustin has knowledge, and he knows the scriptures, and I know that he talks with you and shares with you, Father. And I know that you listen. And I know that there's also the struggles of life that just happen to fall upon all of us. And I'm asking, Father, that you please just help Dustin. Give him the strength to do the things that he needs to do so that he can follow you wholeheartedly. And I know, Father, a lot of us sitting out here, we're saying the same thing. We're believing the same thing. We get so distracted with life and we lose track. But, Father, I'm asking that your Holy Spirit just come upon Dustin. May it come upon him in power so that he sees a difference, so that he knows the difference, so that he knows that all he has to do is come after you and love you with all of his heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I know that the scripture says that. I know that it's hard. But, Father, it's also so easy. Father, I ask that you please just continue to move in his life. And may he be dedicated to continue to read. May he be dedicated to continue to pray. And I pray, Father, that he just realizes and understands and grows so much in you that it just blows everybody away. Father, Dustin is your son. He's your child. And Father, as a congregation, we are praying for Dustin and asking that you just move in his life in a way that just blows everybody away. May your power be revealed. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for allowing him to die on the cross for us and be our Savior. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.